Hi, everyone. My name is Ravi Garla. I'm a consultant with the Nuclear Threat Initiative, and we will be talking about shifting narratives on nuclear weapons and using a case study of an intervention we did with our partner, TaskForce, and Yossi Sergeant, who will be joining us. Yossi is the founder and chief creative content organized cultural organizing officer at TaskForce, and he focuses on kind of using the power of art and artists to shift kind of political conversations. And you'll probably be tired of this one example and anecdote, but he famously commissioned and managed the Hope poster in Obama's 2008 campaign and has done dozens of maybe even more amazing, impressive things since then. I was excited to kind of partner with him on a form of cultural intervention that they've been pioneering in recent years. Just to tease it out, and Yossi will talk about this a little bit more. We did a pilot project in 2022 that resulted, created about 25 graphics or so, and it's been shared peer-to-peer about 180,000 times and viewed an estimated 40 million times. And we'll unpack that. But before we dive into that intervention, I'm going to kind of share more about kind of how this is informed by the research we've done on audiences and narrative. Yossi will then kind of give a briefing on kind of cultural organizing and the 2022 pilot. And then we're going to ask all of you to participate in helping shape kind of work that is going on right now on GIFs and memes and submitting your own ideas. And we'll end with both previewing some work that a pilot we're doing this year on memes and subreddits, and then leave some space for questions. I encourage you during the course of the conversation to submit your questions using the question and answer button on your bar. We'll try to get to as many as possible at the end. And if we run out of time, always feel free to reach out to myself or TaskForce, and we're happy to kind of answer questions or engage in further discussions. But I'm going to get started kind of on sharing more about why this project before Yossi kind of shares the actual project. A lot of people ask, like, why narrative interventions, why cultural interventions, how does that actually relate to the things that we need to see? I show them like an abstract picture of an iceberg to start. The things that we want to happen, people in the street, people contacting elected officials, voting for our candidates that support our issue set. These are all visible forms of power that we seek and want. And those are girded by beliefs and cultural conversations on what is a priority, what matters and what people's aspirations are. And, to take an example, passing a ballot initiative on marriage equality is a visible form of power. But underneath that, the work that, the happening culture with Will and Grace and Ellen was very important in destigmatizing gay relationships and played a huge role in the culture shift that allowed the political change. I like to say that, it's insufficient for us to win a single policy or elect a single champ. The change that we seek in the world must seem necessary for any elected official. And that is kind of the goal that we must set ourselves out to, given this the vastness of the change that would need to happen in a world without nuclear weapons. But we have our work cut out for us. Kind of the status quo usually wins. We have to take a sense of disrupting that. Right now, in the classic organizing diagram, we're a little fish in a big pond, and we lack the political power to achieve our aims. And what we need to do is kind of connect diverse actors, institutions, with varying values and interests to be swimming in the same direction to help achieve the same goals, even if they come from different points. And culture and narratives have a key role in reshaping people's views on that. To start, we need to answer questions of like, who do we need to reach and with what stories, what narratives? In a very simple sense, like who's already persuaded on this issue and who do we need to persuade? And to inform that question, we both leveraged research that the field has been doing for years, as well as commissioned our own research. In 2021, we examined kind of the stories people had in their heads about the future, their hopes and dreams, and saw where it intersected and overlapped with what we're trying to do as a community. Actually on the left are some of the images that study participants chose to reflect their hopes and fears metaphorically of the future. And on the right, we actually have some of the creative and hypotheses on stories and narratives that we tested to help inform it. It's beyond the scope of this conversation to really unpack all the research, but I'm gonna draw out a couple of items that are relevant to our discussion, our strategy. For one of the major kind of outputs was we actually modeled who is persuadable on this topic are able to replicate that. And we have a sense of who they are. When you kind of cut out everyone who is either already agrees with us or is already opposed with us, you're left with this kind of diverse group of people that, generally identify as Democratic or neither party. They skew towards women and younger, and nearly half that audience are people of color. There's also, when we work in kind of narrative and cultural interventions, there's a lot of value in actually using value segmentation rather than demographics, because it's limited in its application. But beyond the scope of what we can cover in this call, I encourage you, if you're interested, to both read kind of the research reports that are being dropped in the chat, and also go to the narrativeobservatory.org. Harmony Labs, which is one of our research partners, has a great introduction to kind of narrative change strategies and includes kind of a section that you get to actually play with that's relevant to rewriting the story on nukes. So I encourage you to check that out. But beyond who do we have to reach? The other question is, when you think about culture, that's a huge ocean. Like, and you can often feel like you're dipping your toe in and you're like, is that going to make a difference? And so we wanted to inform that question, where do our persuadables live in the culture among the million of choices we can make? How can we inform that decision? And we recognize in our space, a lot of us in NGOs of limited capacity and time are primarily focused on daily news and cable news coverage. And, there's a lot of other stuff here that informs the stories that people are living in, day out before they even come to a political topic or question or circumstance. And so in 2022, we examined the stories that people had that examined the stories in our culture. We followed a panel of Americans over a portion of a year and looked at their TV and online habits. And we were looking at, when they're not thinking about politics or nuclear weapons, where were they choosing to spend their time? And when nuclear weapons showed up, how is it represented? What does it tell us about what we need to do as a community? And, to those answers to those questions, in summary, one thing that jumped out immediately was that, they're not watching cable news. That was kind of everyone who's already persuaded, either for or against, most likely are watching cable news. And these people are gravitating more to kind of online sources of information and explainer journalism, if any, kind of traditional journalism. So that was one insight. And the second one, we had a host of different kind of cultural nodes that over-index for our persuadable audience. Two that we actually picked up and will use, and Yossi will talk through, was kind of anime and gaming, which were pretty big in our persuadable audience. And in terms of what is the story that we need, you start with what is the existing narrative in people's head and in the culture. And a gross simplification is, people already feel before we even talk to them that the world is ending. Might not be for nukes, might be climate change, might be pandemics, might be robots. They also kind of agree and prefer kind of desire a world without nuclear weapons. This is not only this study, but other polling has demonstrated this. However, after that, you know, we have to move almost every other measure. People don't see a role for themselves. They don't think progress is possible. And they actually are not exposed to in the culture what a world without nuclear weapons actually looks like, feels like, or why it benefits them. And so kind of a very simplified brief of like what we need to do to reshape the narrative is, you know, we really want to disrupt nukes equals security. We have to disrupt the status quo and win the security argument. We also need to connect with what the audience and the culture actually cares about. How do we broaden the scope of this conversation that we're having? And this is kind of how do we get all those fish swimming in the same direction? And finally, and probably most importantly, is people need a sense of agency for making progress and, you know, what a world without nuclear weapons means to them. And I would highlight this as probably the single most important thing that popped from our research and could be expanded on even further. And, you know, kind of in a very simple way, GIFs combined, GIFs, memes, this area of intervention made sense because it's where our audience was. It gave us some space to actually touch on their cultural nodes. You know, before we go into, you know, influencing the next gaming blockbuster, we can use kind of these gaming worlds in our GIFs and memes. And I'll mention like the one on the bottom left that you see on the screen. Genshin Impact was an anime series that popped in the cultural research, and we're able to use the characters in some of our graphics. I would also add that there's the low cost nature of animated graphics and the high distribution possibility was something that we're excited about starting with, you know, before we're making and producing documentaries. I actually want to hand it over to Yossi, who will actually walk us through both cultural organizing and talk more in detail about the intervention that we undertook with Task Force.
Great, thank you, Ravi. And thank you so much for your partnership and your trust and inviting us into this important work. Everybody on our team, from the internal staff to all of the amazing creatives that we work with, jumped at the opportunity to work on this project because I think we all share a sense of urgency and a desire to see the change. And I think we were all yearning for that hope that you mentioned that we are all so desperate for. Okay, so without further ado, let me present here really quick. Okay, get to presentation mode. All right. So once again, my name is Yossi Sergeant. I use he, him pronouns. I am here in Sleepy Hollow, New York, which is really a place. But I must say that I'm a displaced Angeleno because I don't know. I just feel like I always have to say that. Task Force is an agency of about 15 years. We have a very particular lens and a very particular universe of work that is built upon a couple core practices. And the first of which is cultural strategy, and the second, which is a related cultural organizing. And at the core of that work is two kind of very simple and basic ideas. One is that politics and policy is where some of the people are some of the time, and culture is where all of us are all the time. To put a not so fine point on this, I would argue that there are a very select group of people around the world who are thinking about nuclear threat over 5 minutes of their day, one day out of a week. And most of them are either on this call or within earshot of somebody who is on this call. The reality is, most of us, including the people on this call, have 1,000 inputs into our lives that range from, you know, children to faith to radio stations that we're listening to clothing that we're wearing. We are receiving messages all day, every day, and we're participating in lots of conversations about a diverse set of cultural frames that have very little to do with politics, very little to do with nuclear threat, but are informing the way that we make decisions about all of those. They are either positively driving us towards creating a solution, finding hope, or they are creating a circumstance that we are swimming upstream. We believe that while you need to be both tackling the explicit conversations, as Ravi said, in the media, in the Fourth Estate, to policymakers, to the activists that are directly engaging in the conversation around nuclear threat and nuclear weapons, to those who are, we'll call them issue tourists, and or care, but may not be invited into the conversation in a medium, in a methodology that is comfortable to them. That's kind of the first pillar. The second pillar about how we work is that the most potent and the most powerful culture shapers are our creatives. They are our artists. It is a community of people across mediums, our culture makers, who we entrust with convening us and helping us dream. They take really complex ideas and they distill them down into the most potent visual, oral, ephemeral form. They help us see past obstacles when we just feel like we are up against a wall. They help us dream of a future that we want, that we can envision, and they help us find and believe that we can take steps to reach them. So those are the two basic pillars underneath we do what we do. And what does that actually look like? It is a diverse and big tent of culture, right? Most people, when they think of art, of culture, they think about art, which is just one of the manifestations of culture, right? It looks like the food that we eat, the built environment that we sit in, the digital ephemera that comes in and out of life so quickly, everything from hobbies to practical hobbies, right? The things that we do with our lives every single day, the podcasts we listen to, the books that we read, the news that we listen to, the fun stuff that we do when we're turning off our active brain and we're turning on our creative self. All of these things either reinforcing and are creating an environment that is rich for change or one that is going to mire us in fighting both a cultural battle and a policy battle. And so what does that look like for our agency and what we do? We are actively and consistently involved in movement building. The actual work manifests in 1,000 ways. And we'll get into this a little bit later on, but we've done everything from festivals with 60,000 people talking about mental health, specifically and intentionally, all the way down to very small interventions like the third image that you see in the top about California's schools and prisons, which was a visualization of a data point at an event that has been shared upward of 300 million times on that image alone. I think this year, Kim Kardashian shared it and got basically 300 million views herself. But this was done in 2012, and every year is consistently revisited because it is a beautiful manifestation of a data point, right? That data point would be one line below the fold in a media article, but made manifest becomes something that is compelling and shareable and becomes an exponentially shareable concept, right? So we work with the creative community almost as bridge builders, and then bringing the community together to inform that work, to co-produce that work, to take ownership over that work, and then to share that work back out to the communities that they're a part of. All right, so let's get into a little bit of the why, how we ended up partnering with NTI and what we ended up doing. The reality is that communications are ever evolving. I like to remind people that when we did the hope posters for Obama, that we launched them on MySpace, right? We launched them in an era where you had to learn how to code HTML in order to put music on your homepage. We lived in a time, I believe I did most of that work on a BlackBerry, if I'm not mistaken, at the time. I mean, it was a totally different era. And the tools and the resources that are available to us today were not available to us back then. And some of the opportunities that were available to us back then are no longer available to us now. The universe of magazines and medium formats have shrunk dramatically, the distribution. But social media and social sharing has expanded exponentially. So in an evolving landscape of communications, we too must evolve with that landscape. We must take full advantage of all the opportunity that's in front of us, or we're going to be left behind and our issues will be left behind with them. And what does that look like today? So we here at TaskForce in about 3 years ago launched something called the Into Action Lab. We like to say that we're creating a conversational content machine. It is designed to create the digital ephemera that people need to be their own best advocates. It is a set of tools and resources that drive online discourse, that challenge people into sometimes difficult and sometimes desired conversations online, and doing them about subject matters that are oftentimes not at the core of an intuitive conversation in a community, but when invited in, they will gladly engage in. So what does that look like? Actually, I should have edited this because I'm now noticing we're already at 35,000 pieces of content. That's an error in there, so forgive me. We are mass producing content. The era of trying to get one piece of content to go viral is all but behind us. You posted something an hour ago, you're already looking for something new, right? We are in an era of mass consumed content and content consumed at scale. The amount of content that we're seeing every single day is growing exponentially. And so we need to be keeping up with that pace. What this project is intended to do is to look at parts of the internet which are over-indexing in spreadability and shareability and seeding new narratives into those spaces. How are we looking at the landscape? If the internet has a pH balance, is that pH balance leaning toxic, leaning neutral, or leaning supportive for us, right? And can we introduce into those environments new narratives that challenge the norms and that build a more encouraging environment for people to join us on our journey to end a nuclear threat? And then can we in this process be building power along the way? Can we be identifying people who agree with us and then pulling them into our universe? Can we be equipping our organizations to better service these conversations so that they get more followers, so that they can have a bigger impact, so that they are more persuasive? And in that process, can we be identifying and articulating the networks of people who share these needs, who share these opinions, and to self-identify as our allies, our partners, and to help us achieve our goals. Okay, so some to the basics. Where did we start? We started with GIFs, stickers, and memes. GIFs and stickers are the language of the internet. So let's talk about what they are. This will be quick. A GIF is a short looping animation. A sticker is the exact same thing, but with a transparent background. The two are both serviced by the same libraries, but are used differently on different platforms. GIFs, which tend to be what we call digital yard signs or bumper stickers, are expressing an opinion, usually a pretty succinct one. They're used dramatically or heavily on platforms like Twitter, in SMS, in WhatsApp, on Instagram in the form of an MP4, and on Facebook. Oftentimes on Facebook, most often in the comment section. Stickers are badges. I record a video and I adorn my video with a sticker. It is something that I feel potent enough that I want to bling out my video and attach that message to it. That, of course, is used highly on Instagram stories, on TikTok, on Snapchat, and several other important and useful platforms for us. And then there's memes. Memes are where we get to get into that nuance. Memes are where we get to get into that a little deeper into that persuasion. Memes can be standalone pieces of content that don't need to, that have their own context built into the creative. Whereas GIFs, oftentimes they can, but oftentimes become really a more of a potent attachment to social copy, right? They can either be the same message or they can be a supporting point to that social copy. Now, what does this look like in practicality? We made some assumptions and we did some research in trying to look at conversational content. And what we discovered were that there are two libraries that fuel all of social media's usage of GIFs and stickers. And that those two libraries, which are Tenor, which is owned by Google, and Giphy, which is currently owned by Facebook, but that's being walked back. They control the distribution libraries. They are the repositories that fuel active social media across every platform. And what scale? 12 billion searches a day. One more time, 12 billion searches a day. That puts them at the second largest search engine following Google. So we are not talking about cute, pithy animations that are going to be seen by a small group of people. We're talking about using the second largest search engine on the internet to push one of the most spreadable and shareable forms of content that currently exist on the internet. And what does that look like? For us, we've now grown in the last 4 years to, as I think I mentioned before, 35,000 pieces of content. And, you know, we set out in our first year to hit 1 billion views. And what has happened is, as I think that last slide, you know, illustrates, we're in a place where it's almost hard to comprehend how much this stuff is spreading and scaling. We just passed 270 billion views, but what I think is really, really important is without a single dollar being spent on ads. We are not pushing content at anyone. We are introducing content to an environment where majority of those views come from searching for that content as opposed to pushing content at people. So the initial pilot that we worked on with NTI was 25 GIFs and stickers to promote evergreen NTI goals and values, right? How can we look at some very basic goals and values when you looked into these libraries, and we'll show you in a second. What came up was toxic, both visually and in text. Whereas not reinforcing our values, was not aligned with our goals. How are we going to start to begin the process of reshaping that? We needed to start somewhere. And I think where we started turned out pretty well. And we looked at two basic areas. Can we reframe and disrupt traditional narratives? And can we start to seed potential new visions for what's possible? And this is what it ultimately looked like. Give you a second to look at it. Oftentimes, people don't equate the ending nuclear threat and or nuclear weapons in general with the kind of animation that you're seeing here. But this is the stuff that spreads and scales quickly on Giphy. We had to balance what works on the platform and what the visual language that is sometimes associated or where we want to head with this project. So oftentimes, you know, a polar bear doing meditation may not be the first thing that comes to mind when you think about nuclear weapons and the nuclear weapon threat, but These are the type of visuals that are successful on the platform, so we leaned into them. We also wanted to make sure this content was useful to our partners, and so we held back in some places to make sure that it was partner-friendly as well. And what was that content strategy? What did we make? One, we made like a very basic layer of digital, again, what we call those bumper stickers, right? Badges and bumper stickers that you can put on your profile, you can share with your friends and say, I am somebody who believes that we need to be taking on the nuclear threat, period, right? And then we wanted to also look at the imagery that is currently out there before, and you'll see this in a second, when you looked, a lot of mushroom clouds, a lot of violence, a lot of destruction. Can we reframe the conversation to be less about the destruction and more about the potential that we might be able to manifest, or we are going to manifest ahead of us, a beautiful outcome as opposed to a mutually assured destructive digital space. And then the third would be, can we be providing a set of useful tools where the movement is right now and where the internet is right now? Can we create the assets that the community needs in order to be successful? And what you'll see here on the left is what it looked like before we got there. And on the right is what it looks like now. When you do a search, this is on the left is, again, I don't know how I'm going to use left and right, but it's left on my screen. I'll start that one more time because I think it's worth seeing again. This is what was there before. You'll see nuclear clouds, you'll see a lot of bombs, a lot of people pressing the button, right? Not good. This is not an environment that supports envisioning a future free of nuclear threat. And then today, we have successfully pushed down the content through algorithm manipulation and pulled up the content that we created and that we generated to make sure that that is the content that is delivered when people look for these searches. And these are high traffic searches associated with this issue. Nuclear, nuclear weapons, nuclear bombs. We have a whole list of search terms that we work together to identify that are both important search terms to NTI and to the movement, and that are proximate search terms that are high search volume on the internet. And we did all this using the Harmony Labs research. And what does that look like for the user? When I am on my phone, if I pick up my phone and I hit the Twitter button and I open my Twitter and I compose a new tweet and I type a message and then I want to do an attachment and I hit that GIF button right there in the middle of my phone, and I type in the word nuclear or nuclear threat or nuclear weapon, this is the content that comes up to me. This is what I'm offered. And we are not 100% successful. We cannot push down everything, and we will never be able to push down everything, but we can make sure that we are a dominant force in making sure that what is available offers people a new perspective on what they could be saying in that environment. So whether they actually use that content or not, if you look up the term nuclear threat, this is what you're being delivered. Immediately the work is happening and we're starting our persuasion work. But we do have about a 3.5 to 4% click rate on our content, which when we start looking at those numbers is a lot of shares. And you'll see that right here. So ultimately, what does this look like? It looks like over 40 million views in just 25 pieces over the course of a very short period of time. This was an extremely successful project. And what do we mean by serve views? Serve views is that first thing that I was just saying, that when somebody looks it up, they're offered, these are the old perspectives, here's the content that you can use, and you scroll through that content. We think that those are valuable. It is shaping the narrative in people's heads. And then we assess based on our click-through rates and our share rates, we assign a very modest If this is shared, we assume X number of people are seeing it. Whether that's through SMS and through social, it is extremely modest. I think it's like 100 views per share, which is, it's actually right here, 100 views per share, which, you know, I can tell you is a very, very conservative number for what we're actually achieving. All of this content is available in a repository. It's our library. You should go check it out. into-action.us. There are, like I said, 35,000 pieces of content on there. And we are constantly evolving and updating with the most important and current issue content on the front page. So you will, you know, whether it's International Donut Day, or it is World Water Day, or a very large network is found out to be lying to its audiences, there will be content there for you to jump into those conversations and ready, including all this great content that we're making for the Nuclear Threat Initiative, but beyond. All right, so it's time for us to get into this generation exercise. Ravi, you wanna jump in?
Yeah, thanks, Yossi. We want to take this opportunity to kind of tap the brain trust we have on this call. We have about 40 people on right now. And really, we're currently right now at this exact moment kind of generating GIFs, memes, stickers, and, you know, against the creative brief or what you hope to see in the world when someone types in nuke. Would love to kind of do a short exercise where we all just jump in on ideas, and then we can kind of see which ones we can bring to life in this session. And I should mention, after this conversation, we'll share kind of more of a brief and a way to submit ideas ongoing. We actually just did a review of the last months of content. And, you know, on Reddit, we're seeing kind of conversations on similar themes and reactions. And so we want to reshape kind of what we're creating this next batch. And I'll share more of that later. But next slide, Yossi. Hopefully, what we were hoping for you to do here is just take a second. We're going to give you 3 minutes to kind of craft one prompt and just a line of copy, 3 words, 5 words. You know, brevity is, of course, important in this work, and particularly with this medium. And we shared a link in the chat for a spreadsheet. It'd be great if you can go over to the spreadsheet now and kind of claim a row by plugging in your first name. What we're asking you to do, there's an example in the spreadsheet of kind of the types of responses that we're looking for. I put in just an idea. And again, like the creative brief, like how can we disrupt this idea that nukes equal security? How do we connect with what people in the culture care about? And how do we see possibility for progress in a world without nuclear weapons? And we know that the audience and the medium here is like stickers on Insta, you know, a GIF in an SMS or a meme on Reddit, and thinking about our demographics as well. Next slide, so Yossi. Looks like somebody is having issues accessing the document in there. I apologize. We should still do the exercise. Give me 1 second to see if I can kind of fix the doc share. It looks like people are in there. Let me drop this in and see if this works. It looks like I'm seeing people in the doc, so we'll just proceed. And if you're having problems, just feel free to email me them afterwards. Yossi, next slide.
I'm having a little bit of technical difficulty. Give me 2 seconds.
No worries. I actually think that why don't we actually give people time to do the exercise. So basically, all we're looking for is kind of write like the copy that you wish you could see on a GIF. Three lines. A lot of this, actually, think about what would you write on a protest poster. Or put on a pin that you'd wear to a rally is kind of a useful context to think about the humor, the brevity, and the context that we're looking for. But I'm going to give everyone just 3 minutes. And let you all work. You can work on a piece of pad of paper and then just jot in your ideas. And then I'll read off a couple that we get submitted from the group. So I'm going to give you again, just write a short copy lines and we'll come back together in 3 minutes. Oh, sorry. Yossi is sharing. Just as an example of like, you know, from real world, like some of the taglines from classic taglines from the movement, we've actually been transforming those into kind of digital versions of it. Books Not Bombs and other crafts in that vein, as well as kind of You Can't Hug a Child with Nuclear Arms. So I'm going to pause, give everyone 2 minutes, and then we'll come back together. Thanks. Great. We're going to come back together in about 10 more seconds. So just try to finish your one idea and then we'll get back together. Yeah, so do you want to stop the share? I'm actually going to share the spreadsheet and just share off a couple of them that are up there. Thanks. Okay. Sharing the spreadsheet live. And again, these rough ideas and you know, committing to paper is always just the first step. I am from Peggy, which with the parenthetical, oh my God, I have no idea what I'm doing, has concept number one, GIF piece a chance, great pun. I'm gonna go down to Lisa with hugs for humans, not weapons, hurt. And then Elise with a knot formulation, nuclear chicken wings, not bombs. And Sam, tug, not war, pause against proliferation, playing into the very popular kind of pet meme generation and GIFs. And I'll read one more from Alan. If I threaten to kill their children, they won't want to hurt me, which is a sad but true statement of the current state of affairs. that was a very depressing note to end on. I'm going to try to give, I'll go with Mona with give our children hope for a future without nukes. Great. So after this conversation, we're going to share a more narrow brief on of things that we're actually kind of working on right now to try to solve. And I'll mention that, you know, in our last round of memes, the feedback that we're seeing in the conversation generated was a lot of kind of people responding with, well, nukes have prevented World War III, or, you know, our favorite, which is like Ukraine shouldn't have gave up the bomb, are like one of the two most common refrains that are happening right now. And so we're currently thinking about counter programming on that front. But I'll share this after the call with the recording for people who want to kind of inform kind of the content that we're going to be kind of sharing and distributing. But Yossi, I'm going to hand it back to you on sharing kind of the pilot that we're going on right now. We can't hear you right now, Yossi, or see you. I don't know if that's intentional.
Not intentional. And here we go. All right, go back to sharing. Lo and behold, Era, I've been using Zoom long enough now where you think I would get this down. All right, so what does our 2023 content look like? Where are we? First of all, you're all hired. I loved all those suggestions. We will be putting them to market. I don't know if we can credit you since it's all unbranded and free, but we will try to bring them to life. So this year, we have kind of transitioned and moved into what I would call like a 2.0 version. This has proven to be successful and worth exploring, and we're deepening the way that we're engaging with using very specific audiences in a way that allows us to bring a little bit more nuance to the party. We're really focusing on, like it says here, seeding the possibility that this is possible. We can move past a world with nuclear weapons and with such an overbearing nuclear threat. We can disrupt the status quo that these are keeping us, that weapons are keeping us safe, and the core idea that we can look at what people already care about and already are talking about. Remember that cultural conversation that we started in the beginning. Where are they, and can we connect these ideas to that culture? And ultimately, we think we can. We can talk about a historic blunder and amazing intervention in the context of SpongeBob, right? SpongeBob wins the internet every time. If you want to talk about anything, anywhere, at any point, and have it be funny or shareable, introduce SpongeBob into it. We are able to take something that happened over 10 years ago that was a news headline that a small group of people paid attention to because it was news, right? Most people aren't paying attention to the news, and make it into something that will fit into people who are following an animation cartoon that is extremely possible. Right. This is a summary example of what is possible here. And so ultimately what we did was we really dug deeply into Harmony Labs audit, and we looked at who those audiences are, where they're living, and what they believe in, where are they persuadable, what are those communities' beloved cultural signals. And the three that we kind of really honed in on were gaming, anime, and global citizens. And then ultimately, then we went in and we said, all right, well, let's get into the community, some of the most important places where those communities convene digitally, and where they are sharing the kind of digital ephemera that circulates widely online, and where those conversations might happen. And we do what we call digital door knocking, which is we go in and we introduce ourselves and our content, and then we watch the digital town halls unfold underneath them. And we use that as anecdotal and quantitative learnings on how this content works. And then we adjust and we come back in over and over and over again into these environments. And this stuff is done very intimately. This is not, you cannot push content at people in these environments. They will reject it. You will be banned from participation. You really do have to engage in these spaces. And to be honest, it's a lot of fun. We like doing it. It can sometimes be scary, but to be frank, it is the reason we get into this work. And what does it look like in this context? As you will see here, some of you may know some of these references. I'm going to guess that many of you don't. I myself don't even know. I'll be frank and say I don't recognize a few of these references, what animation this is from. But I promise you, when we drop it into the community, people are like, oh, I haven't seen that character used in this context, right? Or, oh, I, you know, so-and-so memes, you know, I see how they tied, you know, he, in this video game, this is a character that likes to drop that drops a big bomb, and they've used him as a tool to talk, you know, to talk about the power the negative aspects of it. I mean, these conversations get extremely rich, as I'll show you in a minute. But what we're doing is, it's really a simple concept, is, you know, we're making memes about content in video games using video game references for people who like video games. The example I'll give, and I'll post completely out of this for a second, in 2008, when we did the Hope posters, most people know that one poster, but we also did bike spoke cards. When two people get together on a Saturday morning to go for a bike ride, they may talk politics and they may not, probably not, to be honest. But if you introduce a bike spoke card, the thing that goes in the bikes that has Obama's picture on one side and his public transportation policy on the other, you now have a reason for them to engage in that conversation that feels organic, it feels welcome, it feels meaningful. And so can we introduce into these communities the kind of content in a meaningful way that will engage them? And the answer is absolutely we can. And it is working. What you will see in over and over and over again, and this is just a tiny fraction of what happens, is we get deep, meaningful, substantive conversations, people teaching each other, people introducing with each other, hey, this is a reference to this thing that happened and that thing that happened. Here's a link to an article where you can learn a little bit more about that thing. Or, geez, I really care about this and I don't really understand why other people don't care about this. And beyond that, what we're seeing is what we knew would happen and what is proves itself out is what we do on Reddit doesn't stay in Reddit, or it doesn't stay even in the channel that we put it in. So we posted this meme in the R memes channel of Reddit. And it was shared to many places, but here's an example of a few that it was shared to. It was then taken and reshared into other spaces. So people who were, if you look at the kind of top two are what I would call endemic communities, who this is natural content to go into. The one below it, Shitty Skylines, is a little bit more of a nihilist community, a big one clearly, but is really talking about the things that we need to fix out in the world. So also endemic, but a little bit one step removed. And then we have Tank Sinatra, which is a funny meme universe Instagram account. So it moved off platform into social media, where on that post on Tank Sinatra had 300,000 likes on it. So this one post that got 6,000 upvotes on our memes, which is a lot, got shared to multiple other meme channels, and then off platform to Instagram, where it had 300,000 engagements just on that one post. And again, this is just four examples of dozens of places that this was shared and will continue to be shared over time. So what's next? Culture is vast and culture is potent, and culture is the space where we shape narratives that then shape behaviors that then shape outcomes. It is a place where we are already proving that in the digital cultural space, we can have pretty significant impact. We'll continue to do that work. But I want to invite NTI into thinking about the broader tools that culture has available to us, from muraling to out of home to to convening and gathering people, to introducing the battle to end the nuclear threat into other movements as collaborative and interweaving interdependent issues. And to look at micro commissions, as well as expand the offerings in the digital. What you're seeing on the right is an AR filter. What can we do in the AR filter universe on Snapchat, which is still one of the most tremendous resources and gathering for the young generation today? Who knew? It's still a big thing. And I'll give you one example of a thing that we did this year as an example of the kind of potentials that's available to us. 2 weeks leading up to the election cycle, we commissioned 20 top-tier fingernail artists to do art on 20 celebrities ranging from Alicia Keys to Carucci to Halsey to an amazing arrangement, assortment of kind of top tier influencers that just said the word vote. This wasn't a hashtag campaign. This wasn't a campaign that was had C4 orientation on it. This was a play to introduce the value of civic engagement into a community of people that are not, they're going looking for beauty, and they're going looking for beauty product. They are not going to look for civics, right? But then we introduced it into that. We then layered that celebrity and influencer layer with a 12 salon takeover up and down Georgia. We took over 12 in city by city in Atlanta, and we said free nails as long as they have civic engagement as a part of it. And we invited people to come in, and then we invited in high profile people from the community, everybody from NSA UFOP, from Progress Georgia to the mayor's office to celebrity kind of well-known chefs and bakers from the community and sorority leads. And we invited them in to come get their nails done for free. And then we mass produced nail stickers that we sent out to whoever wanted them through Move On. I believe they sent out somewhere in the range of 250,000 of these things. So a lot of them went out the door, and we're seeing all over the country. So again, not a very big project in terms of volume, right? You're not paying for a documentary. This was actually a relatively inexpensive action, but a creative one targeted a very specific community that it was very influential and very impactful for the community that we were able to look into. Data-driven, collecting emails and addresses along the way, and allowing for a funnel of people to enter into the work that we want to end up doing with them to continue to stay in the fight to end, to in this case, civics, and with us together to end the nuclear threat. And that's the work that we're doing currently. I think we have some time for questions and answers.
Yeah. So if you have a question, we actually... we only have a couple minutes together to respect everyone's time. But if you have a question, please use the Q&A button and drop it in. I'm going to direct a couple that we've gotten in during the course of the event. Janelle, cultural strategist extraordinaire, asked the question, are you able to see which audiences are consuming which pieces of NTI content? Super curious which pieces are being used by the persuadable audiences. I think, Yossi, I don't know if you want to react share on that.
Sure. There are, and forgive me for going long and cutting Q&A short. I think there are some really good learnings there. There are limitations to what we can see through social sharing with GIFs. That is you cannot drop a pixel, you cannot trace the individual usage, but we can make some assumptions, right? So for example, if I am making a GIF that is, you know, I'll just give an example. If we're making a GIF about the HBCU sororities and fraternities that says, you know, Kappas vote early, I can make some assumptions about who's using the search term Kappa. Right? We can make some assumptions based on the directional orientation of the search. We can also then on the meme world we have way more control in the meme world because we're putting them into specific communities using specific references and specific audiences that we can get a lot of data on, hey, what is the population or the audience population who are attracted to this kind of a content. So while we can't specifically track and get directly point to specific people and their demographic, we can make some pretty safe bets based on content, based on communities that we're focused on, and based on the search terms and usage. We do get some data from the platforms, but it is limited.
Great. And yeah, I'll mention also, you know, because of the cultural research that we've done, we know what over-indexes in our persuadable audience, even though we won't know precisely who can see which piece of content. Kim, a designer and storyteller, asks, how do you measure the effectiveness of the campaign's influence over attitudes and policy change? I think I'll first start and then throw it over to you, Yossi. I mean, that's why we do the research at the front end, because sometimes when we work in culture, we're not going to have perfect measures of who's watching and what the influence is each time. And so when we create, like, we know what types of stories actually move people productively, or who are the audiences that are movable, that's what we're basing it on. Of course, there are tools that we can use to test some of these things in a more controlled environment. But Yossi, I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
Yeah, I mean, that is correct. Absolutely. I will also, there are two points that I'll make is, I can't tell you a single person that voted because they got the Hope poster, but I can tell you that the Hope poster created an environment where more people were compelled to vote and felt invited to participate, right? And so I do want to say that investing in culture, we have to see that the value of culture isn't always in the direct one-to-one engagement that you often look for in other mediums, one. But I will say that there are some things we can learn. For example, in the algorithms on Giphy on the back end, if something trends towards the top, it means it has higher engagement. We can look at which pieces trend up, which pieces trend down, and we can say, oh, these are the pieces that are the most used. These are the pieces that are the most viewed, because those aren't always the same. And we can start to make some judgment calls based on the data that we were receiving back on the content usage that isn't always the same in the meme world, because there is no meme button on the social platforms. But for each of these mediums, we look at different factors for utility. And then, as Ravi said, later and in more controlled environments, we can start to test the messages and the visual mediums alongside of each other. But mostly that work should be done ahead of the time. And so we're just making more effective visual pieces for language that's already been tested before.
And we're already over time, but I'm just going to ask one last question we got in, and it's kind of more open-ended to you, Yossi, which is, sure. From what you know about the disarmament community and what needs to happen, what are the types of cultural interventions or organizing you think should be considered or should happen?
That's a great question. I would say there is a whole universe, there's a legacy in this movement of print posters. I think back to Sister Corita Kent in California, the famed printmaker, where kind of protest signs, beautiful visuals that can be modernized into a modern visual language. I will go back to say that starting digitally, we just barely scratched the surface for what we need to do and to just create the base coat of content that's needed for people to engage with this issue online. The second thing I will say is for the audiences that were identified in the Harmony Labs work and that we're working in digitally, they all convene in real places and in real times. We should be doing interventions at C3, the largest gathering of video game producers, makers, and audiences. There are world video game competitions happening all over the world that are broadcast everywhere that we can be doing interventions are. There's a whole universe of Twitch that we can be educating streamers and trying to help bring them into this work to boycott certain word usage and change that. There are a ton of ways into this. If you think about what Twitch is, it's a visual environment. People are streaming, sitting in a chair with stuff in the background. And oftentimes they pay for that stuff. But what if we're giving them that stuff for free that makes their backgrounds more interesting and also more favorable and dynamic towards pushing towards people nuclear disarmament, right? And there are so many ways that we could start to think about moving into the larger cultural intervention space. I just think about like what Minecraft offers us in pixelation. There's tons of ways for us to engage in this. We just have to like make the choices. I really want to just applaud Ravi and the entire NTI community for starting this conversation. You are light years ahead of some of the other folks who just aren't even looking into this space. So kudos for you for getting ahead of that curve. I think the results are bearing out. I think we're seeing really good pickup in usage, and I'm just excited to see what comes down the road.
Great. With that, Yossi, thank you so much. I'm so excited that you were able to share a little bit of your brain and your heart and the work that you've been doing with us and for others in other spaces. I also want to thank everybody who joined. Again, we'll be sharing a recording and other ways to stay connected as we continue this intervention and process. But most of all, I hope we've just inspired you to be thinking about how we can be working with a cultural lens and how we might be able to, what are narrative interventions that we could accomplish that would reach the audiences we want to, and just wanted to expand people's minds. So thank you so much for listening, and take care. Best.
Thank you.